Allahu Ekber, Allahu Ekber. Allahu Ekber, Allahu Ekber. Eşhedü en la ilahe illallah. Eşhedü en la ilahe Eşhedü enne Muhammeden Resulullah. Eşhedü enne Muhammeden Resulullah. Hayy ala's-salah. Hayy حي على الفلاح حي على الفلاح الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته Elhamdülillah, elhamdülillah, innelhamdülillah, nehmaduhu ve nesta'inuhu ve nestağfiruhu. Ve na'udhu billahi min şururi enfusina ve min seyyiati a'malina. Men yehdihillahu fela muzillelah ve men yudzil fela hadiyelah. Neşhedü en la ilahe illallahü vahdehu la şerikele ve neşhedü enne seyyidena Muhammeden abduhu ve habibuhu ve rasuluhu. السابق إلى الأنام نوره ورحمة للعالمين ظهوره صلى الله تعالى وعلى آله وأصحابه وأولاده وأحفاده وأتباعه أجمعين أما بعد فيا عباد الله أوصيكم ونفسي العاصية بتقوى الله وطاعته I begin in the name of Allah the most beneficent the most merciful all praise is due to Allah we thank him we seek his help and forgiveness We also seek refuge in him against the evils of our deeds. Whoever Allah guides, nobody can mislead him. And whoever he leaves and go astray will not find guidance. I testify that there is no deity worthy of worship except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Muhammad is his servant and final messenger. May he bestow peace and blessings upon our noble prophet, his family, companions and his followers. Ameen. My respected sisters, brothers and beloved children. As all of you know very well, 8th of March has been celebrated all across the globe as an International Women's Day. Therefore, I would like to dedicate today's khutbah to female members of the community and talk about women in Islam, inshallah. The issue of women in Islam is a topic of great misunderstanding and distortion. Due to lack of understanding of the true status and role of women in society according to the Islamic teachings.
but also duty and Islamic practices in some Muslim societies and the misbehavior of some Muslims, which has been taken to represent the teachings of Islam. In today's khutbah, we will talk about what Islam teaches regarding the rights of women and how the current situation can be improved. In many cultures and societies, women are subjected to mistreatment and segregation. They are treated with disdain. Many see them as valueless and more of a liability. This, no doubt, traumatizes them and more often pushes them to the background. During the Jahiliyyah period, before Islam, there were certain practices in which the men overpowered the women, trampling their fundamental rights, including the right to exist and the right to liberty. There was an era in the Arab world before Islam when female children were killed. Quran says, وَإِذَا الْمَوْءُودَةُ سُئِلَتْ بِأَيِّ ذَنْبٍ قُتِلَتْ. And when the girl child buried alive shall be asked, for what offense was she killed? This clearly was an outright, obvious brutality and an heinous attack and breach of right to exist against women. However, with the coming of Islam, alhamdulillah, some of these injustices against women were completely banned, and women's rights were restored. Regrettably, however, it appears that in some Muslim societies and communities, injustices and breach of women's rights still continue to this day. Not only among Muslims, but also in every society, these problems persist, and women are often affected by these injustices and violence, especially domestic violence. My respected sisters and brothers, there are many reasons for the injustices against women among Muslims. One of these reasons is certain so-called Islamic traditions that are wrongly assumed to be Islamic, that place women at an inferior position as men, denying them some basic rights. Another reason is the weak justice system in many Muslim countries, which results in lack of human rights for both men and women. Finally, another reason is patriarchal practices that can be found in Western societies as well, that are ingrained in our cultures and traditions, unfortunately. To alleviate such injustices, we must restore human rights for women and men and put emphasis on authentic traditions that give the respect women deserve. According to the Quran, men and women have the same spirit. There is no superiority in the spiritual sense between men and women, as Allah places the same spirit in them. In the same way, the Quran doesn't blame Hawa for eating from the forbidden tree. Rather, in Quran, Allah tells us that both Adam and Eve ate from the tree. Both of them discovered the consequences of their disobedience. Both of them seek repentance and both of them were forgiven. Nowhere in the Quran does the same woman is to be blamed for the fall of men. Furthermore, when the Quran speaks about the suffering of women during the period of pregnancy and childbirth, nowhere does it connect it with the concept of original sin. Because there is no concept of original sin in Islam, the suffering is presented not as a reason to remind women of the fall of men. Rather, God has commanded upon mankind to be kind to parents and mentions his mother bore him in suffering upon suffering. وَوَصَيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ حَمَلَتْهُ أُمُّهُ وَهْنًا عَلَى وَهْنٍ. In terms of moral, spiritual duties, acts of worship, the requirements of men and women are the same, except in some cases when women have certain concessions. Furthermore, there is no restrictions in Islamic law that says a woman cannot work or have a profession, that her only place is at home. Also, when it comes to financial security, Islamic law is more favorite in many respects towards women. During the period of engagement, a woman is to be on the receiving side of gifts. At the time of marriage, it is the duty of the husband, not the bride's family. He is supposed to pay for a marital gift, which is called dowry or mahr. The Quran calls it a gift, And it is exclusively the right of the woman. She doesn't have to spend it on the household. She doesn't have to give it to her father or anyone else either. If the woman happened to own any property prior to marriage, she retains that property after marriage. It remains under her control. Also, women can keep her own last name, which is part of her own identity. My respected sisters and brothers, if the woman has any earnings during her marital life by way of investments of her property as a result of work, she doesn't have to spend one penny on that income on the household. It is entirely hers. The full maintenance and support of a married woman is the entire responsibility of her husband. Even though she might be richer than he is, she doesn't have to spend even a single penny. At the time of divorce, there are certain guarantees during the waiting period, which is called iddah, and even beyond for a woman's support. If the widow or divorcee has children, she is entitled to child support. Islam also stopped the barbaric practice of female infanticide, practiced by some Arab tribes before Islam. These misguided primitive people used to bury female daughters alive. The Quran forbade the practice, making it a crime. Additionally, the Quran condemns the chauvinistic attitudes of some people who used to greet the birth of a boy with gladness, but sadness in the case of a girl. Astaghfirullah. What is more, the duty of education, as the Prophet ﷺ said, is a duty on every Muslim, male and female. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us understanding of this very important topic. Ameen. ألا إن أحسن الكلام وأبلغ النظام كلام الله الملك العزيز العلام كما قال الله تعالى وتبارك في الكلام وإذا قرئ القرآن فاستمعوا له وأنصتوا لعلكم ترحمون وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم التائب من الذنب كمن لا ذنب له واستغفروه إنه غفور رحيم استغفر الله استغفر الله استغفر الله اللهم اغفر للمؤمنين والمؤمنات والمسلمين والمسلمات الأحياء منهم والأموات إنك قريب مجيب الدعوات برحمتك.
My respected sisters and brothers, as far as treatment of daughters is concerned, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, anyone who has two daughters and did not bury them like primitive Arabs did in the age of ignorance, did not insult them and brought them up properly, another version adds to this tradition, and also did not favor his sons over daughters, he and I will be like this, holding his two fingers closely together. One time the Prophet ﷺ was seated. A companion was sitting with him. The companion's son came. He kissed his son and put him on his lap. Then his daughter came, and he just sat her by his side. The Prophet ﷺ told the man, you did not do justice. Meaning he should have treated her equally. Kissed her and put her in his lap also. Indeed, whenever the Prophet ﷺ daughter Fatima came to him in front of everyone, he stood up, kissed her beloved daughter and let her sit in his favorite place where he had been sitting. The Quran says in Surah Rum, verse 21, regarding marriage, وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ أَنْ خَلَقَ لَكُمْ مِنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ أَزْوَاجًا لِتَسْكُنُوا إِلَيْهَا وَجَعَلَ بَيْنَكُمْ مَوَدَّةً وَرَحْمَةً إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَآيَاتٍ لِقَوْمٍ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ. Among his sins is this, that he created for you mates from among yourselves, that they may dwell in tranquility with them, and he has put love and mercy between your hearts. Verily, in that are signs for those who reflect. The approval of the consent of the girl to marriage is a prerequisite for the validity of marriage in Islam. She has the right to say yes or no. Husbands and wives' duties are mutual responsibilities. My respected brothers and sisters, although they don't seem to be identical in duties, but the totality of rights and responsibilities are well balanced. When there are family disputes, first the Quran appeals to reason and consideration of positive aspects of one's spouse. It is obvious that monogamy is the norm and practice for Muslims. If we assume that having four wives is the norm,
then we assume a population of 80% female and 20% male, which is impossible on the aggregate level. The only verse in Quran that speaks about polygamy speaks about limiting, not instituting polygamy. The verse was revealed after the Battle of Uhud, in which many male Muslims were martyred, leaving behind wives and children in need of support. This verse shows the spirit and the reason of the revelation of the ayah. The Quran also places obedience to parents immediately after worship of God, then speaks of the mother. In a very concise statement, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Paradise is at the feet of your mothers." Once a man came to him and asked, "O Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who is worthy of my kindness and love?" The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam answered, "Your mother." And he said, "Who is next?" Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam replied, "Your mother." And he again asked, "Who is next?" He again replied, "Your mother." Only after the third time he said, "Your father." Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "I command you to be kind to women." In one of his last commands in his farewell sermon before his death, he kept repeating, "I command you to be kind and considerate to women." In another hadith, he said, "It is only the generous in character who is good to women, and only the evil one who insults them." Let's finish our khutbah with a call to our sisters, mothers, young ladies, and who is listening to our khutbah. Dear sisters, we would love to see you at our mosque. We want you to be more active and leading from the forefront, because we need you. Because society needs you. We realized that whenever we kept you away and other sisters from our mosques, we started to go downhill. Now we are waiting for you where you need to be, where you deserve to be. We promise you that we will support you. We really want to provide whatever you need, not just words, but you will tell us what you really need. We want to adjust the environment, conditions for here for you. We also do not want to say arrogantly, "This is what you really need." This society needs women's initiative. Rumi Mosque needs you. Let's see what we did wrong and we are ready to correct it. Let's serve this society together. This is a call to work together to attain Ridwanullah, the good pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, God's approval. This is an invitation. This is an open invitation to my sisters. And do not forget that responding to the invitation is a sunnah. We are waiting to hear from you. I wish a happy belated Women's Day to all of you, my sisters, my mothers. I pray we will assist you for whatever and whenever you need to become more educated and more active individuals in the society. You are the gems and the heart of the community. May Allah bless you all. Ameen. Alhamdulillahi hamdal kamilin. Wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulina Muhammadin wa alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. تعظيما لنبيه وتكريما لصفيه فقال عز وجل من قائل مخبرا وآمرا إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد كما صليت على سيدنا إبراهيم وعلى آل سيدنا إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد اللهم بارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد كما باركت على سيدنا إبراهيم وعلى آل سيدنا إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد اللهم ارضى عن الأربعة الخلفاء سيدنا أبي بكر وعمر وعثمان وعلي ذوي الصدق والوفاء وبقية العشرة المبشرة وآل بيت المصطفى وعن الأنصار والمهاجرين والتابعين إلى يوم الجزاء اللهم اغفر للمؤمنين والمؤمنات والمسلمين والمسلمات الأحياء منهم والأموات إنك قريب مجيب الدعوات برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون